morning, folks. Welcome to That's My Farm. I'm Jim Shroyer, your host, and we're in luck because we're on the Agronomy Farm at Kansas State University. And I hope you get your cup of coffee and come on back, because we're going to be talking to Mike Stamm, our canola breeder here at K-State. And he's going to be telling us about the breeding program and also some other production practices about canola. So grab your cup of coffee and hurry on back.
Closed captioning brought to you by Ag Promo Source. Together we grow. Learn more at agpromosource.com.
That's My Farm is brought to you in part by Tallgrass Commodities. Big enough to serve, small enough to care.
Good morning, folks. Welcome to That's My Farm. I'm Jim Shroyer, your host. We're in luck because we're on the Agronomy Farm at Kansas State University, and you also have Mike Stamm with us, and Mike Stamm is our canola breeder, and it is a chilly morning, and it's hard for me to talk already. So Mike, tell us the difference between canola oil and rapeseed, or canola and rapeseed.
Okay, canola has less than 2% erucic acid in the oil, and less than 30 micromoles grams of glucosinolate in the meal. So because of those two qualities in the oil and the meal, canola and rapeseed differ. So we like to say that all canola is rapeseed, but not all rapeseed is canola to remember
so
it easily.
Rapeseed is more industrial and canola is edible.
That's right. We use canola oil primarily as a food grade oil. Mm-hmm. We also can use it in biodiesel. The high erucic acid rapeseed is used for both biodiesel and as lubricants.
Right, okay. So in the state of Kansas, we've had a canola project for quite a while now. It's pushing, 20, 25 years?
Yeah, we've been breeding winter canola at K-State now for about 25 years.
Okay, so let's talk about canola production in the state of Kansas and Oklahoma. Where is it grown? Why is it grown? And why should you grow it? Talk a little bit about that.
Winter canola is primarily grown in south central Kansas and then throughout the state of Oklahoma. This past year we had about 45,000 acres. Planted acres this past fall were probably around that 25 to 30,000 acres. We don't have a real good feel just yet. They are down a little bit. But we're looking at growing winter canola in the primary wheat belt of the state, where a lot of continuous wheat is grown, so we can grow it in rotation. That's why it's a really good fit in Oklahoma, and why we've seen more acres in Oklahoma, where they're, you know, pushing 100,000 to a high of almost 300,000 here a couple of years ago.
So why is the, I think I know the answer, but why is it down? Why is the acreage down?
Acreage is down primarily because of the price. Most of our commodities, of course, the price is down over this last year. So we have that kind of going against us. And then when you're growing an alternative crop, which canola still is for the Southern Great Plains, guys typically kind of go back to what they know.
Exactly.
And so
if they're going to lose their rear ends, it's going to be on something they know how to do it.
That's right.
Okay.
Right. So we've seen a decline because of the price, but then we've had a couple of tough years with the crop, primarily due to some survival issues. The winter of 13-14 was bitterly cold, a winter that we really haven't experienced for a number of years. That really tested the crop, and then
that was last year.
We had a terrible drop in temperatures last year, where we were in the 70s, and then this bitter cold came in and dropped temperatures down to 17 degrees in a matter of 24 hours. That pretty much put the crop in a state of shock, and we didn't really recover for that in some of the areas last year, so that kind of hurt acres again.
Well, Mike, don't run off. I know you want to get some earmuffs on here. And folks, now's a good time to get a cup of coffee and come on back, and we'll talk with Mike Stamm some more. See you in a minute.
Buying a car shouldn't be this hard. And at Brown Chevrolet Buick in Wamego, it isn't. It's actually awesome. Whether you want a new or used car or truck, Toby's team can make the deal. Even if you want to custom order a new car or truck, Toby's team can make the deal. See Toby's team at Brown Chevrolet Buick in Wamego. We're awesome. Heinen Brothers, a fourth generation Northeast Kansas farm family, knows how tough farming can be. Farmers helping farmers. Heinen Brothers Ag.
selling and servicing crop protection products, fertilizer, anhydrous ammonia, cover crops, quality aerial and ground application. Call today to learn about our extended term financing program, 800-760-4964. HeinenBrothersAg.com.
Ag Promo Source is a unique group of marketing specialists with one mission: help your ag business grow. Each affiliate has their own area of expertise, and they work together to bring you advice, products, and services. To get started, visit agpromosource.com. Ag Promo Source, together we grow.
That's My Farm is brought to you in part by Tallgrass Commodities. Big enough to serve, small enough to care.
Welcome back. I hope you've got that hot cup of coffee or hot chocolate. We could use some right now. With us, we have Mike Stamm. And Mike, we were talking about survival, or the lack thereof, some problems we've had in the last couple of years. And that's been the biggest, one of the biggest problems we've had over the years. So let's kind of kneel down here and talk about these plots that you have here, and talk about winter survival and how, what you look for.
Okay,
let's. I see a good one right there.
Yeah, we see a really good example of survival here. Canola overwinters in the rosette stage.
Right.
That's the stage that we're in now. Uh-huh. And what we see in the rosette stage are these larger, older leaves here at the bottom of the plant.
Right.
That will often slough off over the winter. You'll sure. lose most of this above ground biomass. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what we're seeing here with these.
Yeah, these got smoked here the last few weeks.
Right. And if you would have been out here in December, you wouldn't have even known that
it was
winter.
December. Yeah. It was almost knee high.
Yeah, it was incredible how much growth was out here. But we see a really good example of a plant that will overwinter successfully. Mm-hmm. We hope, depending on what the weather does now. Uh-huh. But we have the older leaves, and then the newer leaves here in the center.
That's
what
rosette.
We call the crown, the rosette, yeah. Mm-hmm. And as long as that crown remains green like this throughout the winter, uh-huh. when temperature's warm, they get into, we're in the average temperature range of, 40 degrees uh-huh. nighttime, and day temperature average of 40, this crop should overwinter. So this is a really good example of what we want to see. We want to see that crown very close to the ground.
Frozen.
Right, the ground is froze. But we want to see that crown close to the ground, hugging the ground, because that's a great position for the crop to overwinter.
Okay, so what you're saying is the further away that crown, which we have right here, is above the surface, the more likely it's going to winter kill
right,
or
right.
damage.
Uh-huh. One of the things we look at is of the different varieties is the crown height. Mm-hmm. There's not a perfect correlation between crown height in the fall versus winter survival.
Right.
But typically, if that crown is hugging the ground like that, that's very good. There's a very nice root system underneath this plant as well. We'd dig it up if it wasn't
frozen.
But you'd see a tap root and roots and so forth. So
what kind of a stand loss can you get, and what's an acceptable stand loss or winter damage and still come up with a pretty good crop?
Typically, we don't want to see any stand loss,
sure.
because that helps when it comes to harvest with balancing out the maturity.
Flowing into the combine.
Right. You don't want big gaps in the field. But I've seen crops that have had 30% survival produce just as much as a crop that's overwintered at 100% survival. It's an incredible plant for its ability to branch out. But yeah. that winter kill has to be even across the field. It can't be just big pockets here and there. You want kind of an even distribution of that the winter kill in order for that reduced stand to produce a good crop.
Okay, Mike, I think it's time for us to go get some hot chocolate.
Sounds
good.
Folks,
we'll be right back after these words from our sponsors.
The Kansas Wheat Innovation Center in Manhattan is rediscovering ways to get improved varieties and new genetics in the hands of farmers faster. Grower-led and Checkoff-funded research initiatives are bringing about positive change. This grassroots leadership provides a strong voice in Topeka and Washington, D.C. Now is the time to partner with Kansas Wheat in moving wheat forward. Kansas Wheat Commission and Kansas Association of Wheat Growers, farmers investing in their future and yours. Log on to rediscoverwheat.org.
We started farming in 1970. It was harder work then than it is now, a lot more physical work and the wear and tear on my knees and my body. Now here I'm 70 years old. I started having knee pain here 4 or 5 years ago, and so I was looking for a stem cell clinic, and lo and behold, my good friend John Farley and Ken Wood, who'd been customers and friends for a number of years, opened their clinic, and in about 2 months my heel was a lot better, and then at the end of 3 months and then going on 4, my knee started making significant improvement, and it's sure been a blessing, because before I had the stem cells, I'd be driving a tractor, and if I sat in a tractor for 2 or 3 hours, when I got out, I'd have to stop and get the kinks out of my knee and shake it. And today, that's not a problem.
Kansas Farm Bureau, the voice of agriculture, represents grassroots agriculture. The state's largest and most powerful farm organization stands up for its members through leadership development, agriculture education, legal defense, environmental advocacy, farm safety, and risk management. Members also enjoy money-saving benefits. To join our organization today or to learn more, go to www.kfb.org or find us on Facebook and Twitter.
Valley Vet Supply is devoted to providing information and professional quality products at reasonable prices.
Valley Vet Supply.
That's My Farm is brought to you in part by Tallgrass Commodities. Big enough to serve, small enough to care.
Welcome back to That's My Farm. I'm Jim Shroyer, and with us we have our canola breeder at K-State, Mike Stamm, and we've been talking about survival of canola being one of the bigger problems that we've had recently or in production in general. But let's talk more about production practices. You know, when do you plant, how much, what kind of fertilizer, that sort of thing.
Okay. Well, our typical planting window for Kansas is the month of September. And so we'll start in the early part of the month in northern Kansas and work our way down to the southern part of the state for the latter part of September. So that's really the target month. It's a pretty narrow planting window, so you have to kind of keep that in mind. There's a bit of a difference there with it and wheat.
You know, sorry to interrupt you, Mike, but you know, 30 years ago, 35 years ago, when we were talking about canola, we were talking about planting mid-August. Mm-hmm. Now, is this an improvement in the breeding for winter hardiness or growth vigor in the fall?
We understand more about how it will perform if it's planted too early versus, uh-huh, you know, uh-huh, planted in that optimum planting window of September. So we've learned a lot, okay, in terms of our production practices. You know, some of the things that we've looked at are different row spacings of canola. It's a real plastic crop, so it could be planted anywhere from a 7.5-inch row to a 30-inch row.
Okay.
So some producers have moved to 30-inch rows so they can plant in no-till to manage the residue using row units, trash whippers, and those kinds of things.
Because we've had bad luck, basically.
Right.
Intuitively, you would think that crown would be protected,
right,
in narrow rows in that residue, but that hasn't been the case.
It hasn't been the case. There's a microclimate effect of that residue in the, mm-hmm, seed row that, mm-hmm, buffers the temperatures, and temperatures are just colder when there's residue there.
Right. Yeah. Right. Okay. So, okay, continue with the production aspects.
Okay. You know, most growers are planting it in conventional tillage. We have to have conventional tillage practices that are good for winter canola, which means, you know, we're not over tilling the soil. It is a small seeded crop. You know, it's planted at a half to an inch deep, and so we need to have shallow tillage practices, use more minimum tillage, I would say, than conventional tillage.
Right.
Those are good practices to use.
Seeding rate.
So seeding rate starts to get a little bit complicated because we're starting to see more hybrids being introduced. You know, we've typically been an open pollinated,
right,
cultivar market. Now we're seeing more hybrids.
Mm-hmm.
We found that we can plant the hybrids at a reduced seeding rate versus the open pollinated varieties.
Mm-hmm.
So we've done a lot of experimenting with the seeding rates in both open pollinated and hybrids. And so our typical seeding rate, I would say, for an open pollinated variety is around 5 pounds, mm-hmm, per acre. For a hybrid, you know, we're looking at more like 3 pounds per,
right,
acre, just because of the hybrid vigor and the branching ability of those types.
Okay. My cameraman's waving at me, so hang on. Folks, come right back after these words from our sponsors.
Sh- Soil is the life of a farm. And for 25 years, SureCrop Liquid Crop Nutrition has helped growers produce abundant quality crops while preserving and improving the soils they steward. SureCrop offers complete soil and plant analysis with cropping recommendations, delivery direct to your on-farm storage, and quality crop nutrition custom blended for your field. Choose SureCrop for the assurance of excellence for your soil. Call today or visit their website for more information.
Next time you see a beautiful field of corn, reach out and thank the farmers who work tirelessly to raise corn for livestock feed, renewable fuels, and exports to feed a growing world population. The farmers on the Kansas Corn Commission work for Kansas corn with grower-funded checkoff dollars that support foreign and domestic market development, research, promotion, and education to expand opportunities for Kansas farmers. To learn more, visit kscorn.com.
Tallgrass Commodities offers producers bulk commodities at a reasonable price with reliable service throughout the whole Midwest. To find out more about Tallgrass Commodities, visit tallgrass.us or call 785-494-8484. That's My Farm is brought to you in part by Tallgrass Commodities. Big enough to serve, small enough to care.
Welcome back to That's My Farm. I'm Jim Shroyer, and I'm Chili. And with us, we have Mike Stamm, our canola breeder. And we were talking about some of the production practices that producers are using, but we wanted to talk about fertility and maybe some weed control. So let's talk fertility a little bit.
So our general recommendations for fertility are, you know, around 100 pounds of nitrogen. Your P and your K are very, very similar to what they are for winter wheat. For sulfur, we want at least 20 or 30 pounds of S available. Sulfur is really important because it is an oil seed, so we need sulfur to produce both protein and the oil in the seed. So that's very, very critical and something we need to be aware of with canola. Mm-hmm.
So 100 pounds, I mean, is that just a blanket or is that a target for, you know, a 1,200 pound or a 2,000 pound yield? So where are we talking about for target yields?
Target yield for 100 pounds would be around 2,000 pounds to the acre or 40 bushel. You know, I tell producers, you know, that's the minimum yield that we really want to shoot for. So, you know, guys that want to push the yield envelope will sometimes do 125, 150 even for canola. Canola will take nitrogen. It's not afraid to use it.
Now, so is that a pre-plant or do you do it like wheat? Do you do some post-emerge or top dress in the spring? How do you, what do you do there?
My general recommendation is to do about a third in the fall and two-thirds in the spring.
Oh, really?
You know, we don't want to over-fertilize canola in the fall. We can get that excessive fall growth that we talked about that can be detrimental to survival. Mm-hmm. We do want to have some fall fertility. I mean, that's critical for overwintering.
Sure.
But, you know, a third of that nitrogen up front and then the rest top-dressed in the spring is a good general practice.
Okay, weed control.
Weed control is really important with this crop. You know, that's why we're rotating it with wheat, is to control the grassy weed species in wheat that can be often hard to control with the herbicides that we have for wheat.
Right.
So we can use products like Assure, Select, Post for grass control in canola. We also have Roundup Ready canola, which is still a very useful trait for this crop. In that wheat belt in southern Kansas on into Oklahoma, where they have major issues with grassy weed species like feral rye and rescue grass and downy brome and cheat and all those, that whole class of grassy weed species. So Roundup is also a very good product for controlling mustards in canola, and that can be quite a challenge.
It would be very difficult. Well, what do producers have to worry about with carryover in that rotation? I'm thinking of wheat herbicide.
Right. We do have to be aware of the sulfonylurea herbicides, which can have long plantback restrictions for winter canola. We're talking about herbicides like, you know, Finesse, Maverick, Olympus. We have developed varieties that have sulfonylurea carryover tolerance that can be planted. We can plant varieties that have the sulfonylurea herbicide carryover tolerance. You can avoid that plantback restriction for the SU herbicides by planting one of those varieties.
Right, well, that is a big issue, knowing and the producers have to think about that in their rotation if they're going to canola. Stay with us. We got one more thing to cover. That's the breeding program. Folks, stay right with us. We'll be right back after these words from our sponsors.
Grain sorghum is one of the most important cereal crops worldwide, and Kansas leads the nation in its production.
Over the years, sorghum has been either exported, used in animal feed domestically, or for other industrial uses. Recently, its use in the ethanol market has seen tremendous growth, with 30% of domestic sorghum typically going to ethanol production. Kansas Grain Sorghum is committed to sorghum research, market development, and education. Learn more at ksgrainsorghum.org.
When your living depends on agriculture, you can depend on KFRM 550 AM. If you're in the southwest three-fourths of Kansas or the northern half of Oklahoma, catch us at 550 AM on the radio dial. But if that isn't you, listen on your cell phone at TuneIn Radio or on your computer at KFRM.com. We promise to keep you informed, entertained, and company as you go through your day. KFRM 550 AM, the voice of the plains, we would like to join your management team.
That's My Farm is brought to you in part by Tallgrass Commodities. Big enough to serve, small enough to care.
Welcome back to That's My Farm. I see you got a cup of coffee. And with us we have Mike Stamm, our canola breeder. So, Mike, we're obviously in a nursery here, and it's kind of burnt back pretty good. But tell us about the canola breeding program here at K-State.
So like we touched on earlier, we've been breeding winter canola at K-State now for about 25 years. And I would say probably one of our greatest contributions to the winter canola industry in the U.S. is improvement in winter hardiness. We had to start basically from scratch because we had nothing that would survive our winters.
I remember years ago we were bringing varieties in from Poland.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you can see here that we've made quite an improvement in survival. So that's definitely been one of the biggest contributions of our program. Yield is also, you know, very important. Farmers want yield. Mm-hmm. Oil content is very, very important for this crop. Our crushers now have oil discounts, so if the oil percentage isn't high enough, they get a discount on the price. And so we need to develop better varieties that produce, you know, more oil per acre, higher percentages of oil. So farmers don't get those discounts at the crusher. That's really important for this crop. We're also interested in herbicide tolerance. So we have a Roundup Ready portion of our breeding program. Mm-hmm. We're also interested in conventional canola, and we're standing in our conventional nursery here today. Mm-hmm. Our Roundup Ready nursery is south of town. We keep those two separate as to not have any cross-contamination
or
materials and so forth. So those are really important traits to us.
Well, Mike, what about diseases? I know up north in Canada, you know, there are a lot of problems with blackleg. And some of those diseases. So, what are you doing as far as disease resistance? What are our disease problems here?
Our primary disease, of course, is blackleg, and that's pretty much everywhere that winter canola is grown in the region. So it's something that we have to face, and it is the most detrimental disease to winter canola.
But crop rotation, like every 4 years? Every 4 years?
Yeah, 3 to 4 years is typical for Southern Great Plains farmers. We're looking at developing resistance to blackleg. We're actually increasing our first blackleg tolerant variety in the greenhouse right now for potential release here in the near future. Mm-hmm. But we have to have varieties that have blackleg resistance because I think it's going to become, you know, the major issue that we face in terms of diseases as acres continue to grow in the southern plains. Other diseases that we see oftentimes are sclerotinia or white mold. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, there isn't any resistant variety to sclerotinia right now in winter canola, so we have to use fungicides, which are very effective at controlling that disease.
Right.
We also see a little bit of alternaria and other things like that, but the two primary ones are blackleg and sclerotinia.
Okay. A number of plots, number of crosses, and how long does it take to release a variety?
Right. We do anywhere from 100 to 200 crosses in a year. Mm-hmm. And our typical time frame for releasing a variety is around 10 to 12 years. So it's quite an investment. Mm-hmm. We have varieties in all stages of development from the initial cross all the way to the finished product. Right. We have two varieties that we're hoping to release this coming summer. Mm-hmm. We have one that has shown enhanced winter hardiness. Mm-hmm. That's a conventional. We also have one that is a SU carryover tolerant variety that we're hoping to release as well.
Mike, I really appreciate you taking time on this cold day. And thank you for joining us. And folks, thank you for joining us as well. And don't forget, next week, about this same time, we'll have another issue of That's My Farm. See you then.
Closed captioning brought to you by Ag Promo Source. Together we grow. Learn more at agpromosource.com.